Welcome. Bethel is an inclusive faith community seeking to transform lives by exemplifying the unconditional love of Jesus. We extend a cordial and heartfelt welcome to all who join us today in worship in person, via Zoom, or live stream. Welcome to those new to the Christian faith, those who are longtime followers of Christ, as well as those who are just curious about faith in Christ. To our friends who are without a church home, and to those visiting with friends and family from another faith community. To those who need strength, want to follow Jesus Christ, have doubts, or do not yet believe. To people of every color, culture, sexual orientation, gender identification, economic background, age, size, ability, and challenges. Old friends and new guests. To the old and the young, believers and questioners, and questioning believers. We welcome you to worship with us on this day. Thank you. I just want to take a moment to make an announcement. We have every morning during Lent at 7 a.m., you're invited to participate via Zoom in a very brief devotion led by Pastor Kenneth. And it is very brief. Hop on. Maximum 8 to 10 minutes at the most of your time. You don't even have to turn your camera on, so all are welcome. It's a good way to center yourself and focus on God before the day takes over. The Zoom link is available in the Bethel Light. If you want to share your prayer concerns or praises with your Bethel family, email them to the church office and they will be included in the weekly Bethel Light newsletter. As always, see the Bethel Light for details on everything that is going on with Bethel in the upcoming weeks. Thank you.
Thank you, Kenya, and may the peace of our Lord be with each and every one of you.
Also with you.
Also with you.
Please join us in singing 10,000 Reasons.
Your holy name.
Today's scripture reading is from Hosea 1, 1 through 10. The word of the Lord that came to Hosea, son of Beeri, during the reigns of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, kings of Judah, and during the reign of Jeroboam, son of Jehoash, king of Israel, Hosea's wife and children. When the Lord began to speak through Hosea, the Lord said to him, "Go, marry a promiscuous woman and have children with her, for like an adulterous wife, this land is guilty of unfaithfulness to the Lord." So he married Gomer, daughter of Diblaim, and she conceived and bore him a son. Then the Lord said to Hosea, "Call him Jezreel, because I will soon punish the house of Jehu for the massacre at Jezreel, and I will put an end to the kingdom of Israel. In that day I will break Israel's bow in the valley of Jezreel." Gomer conceived again and gave birth to a daughter. Then the Lord said to Hosea, "Call her Lo-Ruhamah, which means not loved, for I will no longer show love to Israel, that I should at all forgive them. Yet I will show love to Judah, and I will save them, not by bow, sword, or battle, or by horses or horsemen, but I, the Lord their God, will save them." After she had weaned Lo-Ruhamah, Gomer had another son. Then the Lord said, "Call him Lo-Ami, which means not my people, for you are not my people, and I am not your God. Yet the Israelites will be like the sand on the seashore, which cannot be measured or counted. In the place where it was said to them, 'You are not my people,' they will be called children of the living God." Here ends the reading.
So after hearing that reading, you're probably thinking one of two things. Chose the wrong Sunday to come to church. Or I chose the wrong text to preach from. We're doing this series where I'm presenting lectures by Dr. Howard Thurman. Howard Thurman was a mystic, but he has profound insights into scripture. And so in celebration of Black History Month, I've been doing some of his lectures. I've actually only done one, the one on Micah, the first Sunday in February. And then this Sunday, I'm doing Hosea. And just to finish out the Black History theme, since we had a wonderful presentation by Dr. Aaliyah last week, I'm going to do Amos for the last one next Sunday. And some of these are very deep and profound lessons, and the subject matter, as you just heard, can be very challenging. So just process as you can, and hopefully you can take some grains of wisdom and insights away from that. Let's pray. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Here begins the lecture by Howard Thurman. Hosea is the second of the writing prophets, and unlike Amos, Hosea was a peasant. He was a rural. He was a dirt man. He was sensitive. He was a poetic person. He was gripped by one terrifying passion, and that was that Israel belonged to God and that God belonged to Israel. His concern was with the abandonment of their religious belief. Israel had abandoned their belief in God, and his concern was the way in which Israel worshiped. Hosea is not particularly concerned, as Amos was, with righteousness, as we will see next week. He's not concerned with the way the impersonal city, the people in the city dwelt. He wasn't concerned about that. He wasn't concerned with the business person, the traffic on the city that tended to cause people to build power and security for themselves. He's not concerned about that. In a secondary manner, being cut off from having the face, the contact with all the misery of the world, that's not Hosea's concern. We find nothing in Hosea's writings that says, "Let justice roll down like a river," as we will find in other writings. He's not concerned with social issues as such, but he is concerned with personal piety. And the way in which that piety makes it possible for an individual to live a life that is really worthy of God. That's Hosea's primary focus. And whenever you're studying scripture, you should look at what is the focus or the agenda of that particular writer. This is total sidebar, but if you're looking in the Gospels and you're reading Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, all of those four Gospels have different emphases. And that's important to know because each of them are speaking from their particular vantage point and how they understand the happenings of their day. And the three, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, again, this is just a total sidebar, are called the synoptic gospel because they have similar stories that recount similar events in the life of Jesus. But when you get to the gospel of John, most scholars call that a different gospel because John's focus is on Jesus being the Son of God. And so when you're reading biblical texts, you have to say, what is the focus of this particular writer? What is this writer really trying to communicate to me? And so Hosea's story is one that's really a very tragic one. In some ways, he married a lady named Gomer. She was the daughter of a man who was one of the leaders of the Baal cult. And their first child was born, and he said the name of that child was Jezreel, and for the valley of Jezreel that Jehovah would wreak vengeance on and destroy upon Israel, violating the covenant and falling away from worshiping God to worshiping false idols. Gomer became barren. She was unable to have children after that. And so she had the life that she had lived before she married Hosea, because she was now unable to have children, was the life that she went back to after she had her first child. That's an interesting point. You got to file that one away. That she went back to the life that she was living after she discovered she couldn't have any more children. So, total sidebar, if you want, take notes. If you want to listen to a really entertaining, well, maybe I shouldn't describe a sermon as entertaining, but if you want to hear a really entertaining sermon on this text, Google Jasper Williams and his sermon entitled, I Fell in Love with a Prostitute. I mean, it's about an hour long, but it's a total different take on this particular text, which focuses on different elements of this text, and primarily the role of Gomer and her relationship with Hosea. It's a very interesting thing how the things that loom significance in our life, the things that we are accustomed to, are the things that we go back to in times of crisis. The habits, the idiosyncrasies that we have. Pay attention to that this week. What's your go-to in times of crisis? You know, for some people, they go up in a, roll in a shell when they're in a time of crisis. For some people, they're ready to duke it out. What is your go-to? In Gomer's life, she went back to what she was accustomed to. She went back to what she was familiar with. And at the times when our back is against the wall, in those times of crisis, usually the things that are intimate part of our life and process of living is what we end to go back to. That's what Dr. Thurman is suggesting. It's very interesting. When the pressure begins to get really close, when it gets really close on us, the things that we reach for are the things that are the deepest part of our experience, the things that has long sustained us. Think about that. Think about your life What's your go-to? Sustained us as a part of our, do you have any personal examples? I'm not asking you to share, but do you have any personal examples of that? Here, Dr. Thurman then begins to tell the story of when he was in divinity school, and one of his classmates was a Japanese fella. And he said, this Japanese fella, he spoke perfect English. You couldn't tell by listening to him that he was born and raised in Japan. But in the middle of his sermon for his graduation, in the middle of his sermon, he said something that hit a core of his culture, and he began to preach in Japanese. That was his go-to. And there have been occasions when I've been preaching and people say, you didn't even hear yourself say something in Jamaican dialect. I said, no. But people have come up to me and said, Kenneth, you didn't say this. You said this, this, and that, this, and that. So when Gomer wanted another child and she couldn't have a child, the behavior patterns with which she was familiar resurfaced. Think about your life, think about my life. What comes to the surface when the back's against the wall? I'm not judging, just asking you to make some introspection. The behavior patterns which she was familiar with resurfacing came to the rescue. It was her go-to. So what did she do? She went back to the temple Baal, and in the ceremonial of significance, she became pregnant. Scholars called it the temple prostitution. And she conceived. It's very interesting, isn't it? That this is, I don't want to, and I'm this is Dr. Thurman's words here. And he's kind of having this conversation with the people as he's speaking. And he said, I don't want to get off on the side, but he says it's very interesting. And that's what Gomer did. That's what she did. We understand that. So this child that was born after was given a name by the prophet. And then another child, and then another child. Now, according to Jasper Williams in his very entertaining sermon, he says, and I haven't verified this, but he said that Gomer ended up having several children, and Hosea would later find out that none of these children were his. She went back to the lifestyle that she was familiar with. Now, let me just say here, I know that often scripture paints a really not so nice image of women. So I'm not here to support that. You know, and I don't usually preach on texts like this, but it's just, it's one of the lectures that I thought was very powerful. So she has all of these children, one by Hosea, and then has all of these children afterwards. Then he would later discover that none are his. But all of that was what was deepest in Hosea. And he came to the rescue in this crisis. And what was deepest in Hosea was that God, Jehovah, was the God of Israel and had a private covenant. When you think of the word covenant, what do you think of? You know, Sean, when you think of the word covenant, you probably think of a legal binding contract. That's the way attorneys think of covenant. But when clergy persons think of covenant in terms of like the covenant of marriage, for example, it's the term that I like to use, it's a promise of the heart. It is a contract and it is legally binding, but the covenant of marriage is a promise of the heart. It's my heart promising another person's heart that I will keep this promise with you. And so Jehovah had this covenant. Jehovah had this promise, this binding of the heart with Israel. And Israel went flirting after other gods. That's, in a nutshell, what Hosea's book is trying to develop, this story. So Gomer then is used as an example of Israel going after, you know, you're in this relationship, you're in this binding covenant of the heart, this promise of the heart. But when things didn't work out, she went looking for something else outside of the binding covenant that she had. And that's the same thing that Israel did. When things got bad, their go-to was not to Jehovah, but their go-to was to the other gods. And so Gomer became known as a harlot, an outcast, in the love of her husband. And Hosea could not forgive her, not merely because he had borne other men's children, but because she had dared to insist that the other way of living was better than how she was living with him. And if she's right, reason the prophet, if she is right, then the nerve center of our heart is kind of paralyzed. How could that be? If Gomer is right about Baal, if Gomer is right that things were better outside than inside of the relationship, then maybe Israel was wrong about Jehovah. That's what Hosea is questioning. If it's better, you know, like they say, the grass looks greener on the other side. My mom used to say, if the grass looks greener on the other side, then the water bill is a little bit higher too. If she's right that she can get better out there, then what does that say about God? Does that mean that I can get better if I go to another God? That's the question that Hosea is raising. The meaning of life, the faithful significance of this promise, this binding contract, this promise of the heart that God had between Israel, the magic and the mystery and the beauty of God kind of surrounding Israel as God's people. Yahweh over Baal is the question that Hosea really wants to ask us to consider. What about in our relationships with God? What happens when things don't go the way we want them to go? What happens when the prayer isn't answered? What happens when the door isn't open? What happens when the way isn't made? What happens when that relationship was just going, and then all of a sudden it turns? What happens when there's more days in the month than money in the bank? I had to get that right. I had to think about it. What happens then? Where's our love and our trust and our faithfulness then? That's really the question that this text is asking about how Israel related to God, not only in the good times. It's easy to pray when things are going well. It's easy to read your Bible. It's easy to come to church when the cupboards are full and the accounts are full and all of the children are healthy. It's easy to do that. What happens when those things aren't the way they're supposed to be? And that's the problem with Hosea. Whatever your problem may be, however great our tragedy may be, if we can somehow kind of pull it to some kind of downsize, minimize it, we can really take care of it. And that's what Hosea is trying to do. He's trying to downsize the problem. That's what the children of Israel are trying to do. They're trying to downsize the problem. But if we pull it to the downsize and it still gets overwhelming for us, what do we do then? What do we do then? That's what Hosea is trying to do. How can I manage this problem? How can I think about it in a way that will keep me from being destroyed by it? How God isn't answering the prayer. How can I manage this problem? And then Hosea said, maybe I'm being taught something about Israel because of this situation. Look at Israel. She has behaved the same way that Gomer behaved. And what has God done? What has Jehovah done? Well, Jehovah is hurt, according to Hosea. Jehovah is just as hurt as Hosea was hurt about the relationship. And when Hosea felt, you see, that Jehovah was hurt as he was hurt, for fundamentally the same reason, that kind of softened Hosea's hurt. Because Jehovah's shoulders were much broader than Hosea's shoulders. And then he could shift a little bit over to Jehovah. He could manage his anger. He could manage his frustration a little bit because he says, oh, God's going through the same thing that I'm going through. That's a story in a nutshell. And of course, that is at once the secret of confessional, isn't it? It's very interesting. So Hosea says, Jehovah looks upon Israel with the same sort of anger, with the same sort of disgust, with the same sort of disdain and pity. Then he looks upon them with compassion. Why? Because God loved Israel just as much as Hosea loved Gomer. And because Jehovah loved Israel, Jehovah could never let Israel go. That's a sermon in a nutshell. That God loves you and I so much that no matter what we do, no matter where we go, God cannot let us go. So what does Hosea do? Hosea goes chasing after Gomer. And love brought her back. Hosea goes to where she is, you know, and sometimes we, you know, in the church, we build a building, we say, you need to come to us, but sometimes the church needs to go to where people are. It's not about building a steeple, it's about going where people are, sitting where they're sitting, standing where they're standing. Hosea goes to her and love brought her back. I could go on and on, but I'm going to stop right there and say, I don't know who needs to hear this. Or I don't know who you need to tell this to. It doesn't matter where you've been. It doesn't matter where you are. God comes chasing after you. Isn't that a song? God comes chasing after us because of the covenant that God has made with us, the promise, the heartfelt promise that God has made with us. Let's pray. Thank you, Dear God, for this, it's a tragic story, it's a sad story, and we have already acknowledged that it doesn't paint women in a favorable light. And so we thank you for those stories like Mary that balances it out, you know, the mother of Jesus in scripture. But it does paint the love that you have for each of us in a favorable light. Sometimes we feel that we've missed the mark. Sometimes we feel that we have messed up. Sometimes we feel that there is no redemption for what we did, said, where we've been, what we failed to do. And so thank you that love comes chasing after us in the person of Jesus Christ. Amen.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up till I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Is running after me. Come on. Your goodness is running after me. One more time. Your goodness is running after me. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow you all the days of your life. Amen. Beautiful song selection. We're at the offering time, and we just want to thank you for being here. Thank you for your support of this ministry. Thank you for your faithfulness in giving. On the screen in a few seconds will be the ways that you can give, but you give in so many other ways of your time and your energy. And so if you are able to financially support this ministry, we make you one promise that we will use the gifts to the best of our ability to spread the love of God in this community and beyond. Let's pray. God, we thank you for those who are able to give of their time, of their talents, and even of the resources that you continue to bless us with. And we ask a blessings on the gifts and on the givers. In Christ's name, amen. Yeah. I'm going to just say a brief prayer. Lots going on in our world. Sometimes I got to be honest with you, I turn off the news just because I get overwhelmed with all of the stuff that's going on. But to be connected and informed, I turn it on and I realize why I turned it off. But let's pray. There's so many things. If I miss something, then you offer it up when we offer prayer. God, we thank you that the words of that song are not just words that we sing because they sound nice, but hopefully we have experienced that in our life. The goodness and the mercy of God running after us, reminding us in every moment of each day that nothing can separate us from the love of God. Neither height nor depth nor principalities nor powers nor things past nor things present nor things to come. I am persuaded that nothing can separate us from the love of God. And that love that you pour into each of us, that you run after us, chase us down to share with us, we pray that it fills us so much that it pours out of us, out of our eyes, our hands, our mouth, to everyone we come in contact with. There's so many needs in our world today, dear God. So many places where we see pain and hatred and war and violence and injustice. But there are also so many places where we see the love of God and the compassion shining through. And we pray that we never lose sight of those places where people are loving people, where people are treating people as people and not things, where our hearts are being touched by the injustices in the world, and we're speaking out, we're standing up, we're sharing from our blessings to be a blessing to someone else. We thank you for every person that's a part of this faith community and all of the families that they represent. And we pray your continued blessings upon this ministry, that you will continue to lead us and guide us in ways that bring glory to you, O God, and help our fellow siblings in this world. Lord, in your mercy, receive our prayers. At this time, I offer an opportunity for those of you who are gathered here, and shortly for those who are worshiping with us via Zoom, to offer up your praise report or your prayer requests. Shane is going to take the mic around for those who are here, and if you have, just raise your hand and he'll bring the mic to you with me in whichever form you are comfortable with or you remember. Let us pray. Our Father, Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, pure and holy, tried and true, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a living, I'll be a living sanctuary for you. Sanctuary for you. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, he blessed it, and he broke it, and then he gave it to his disciples and said, take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. After supper, he took the cup and he gave thanks and he said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, the new heart promise in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me. These are the gifts of God for you, the people of God. Will you help me serve communion today, please? You're invited to come. Blood of Christ shed for you.
Amen.
The blood of Christ shed for you. 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 Let's pray. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace now and forever. We give you thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through the healing power of this gift of grace. And we pray that in your mercy, you would strengthen us through this gift in faith towards you and love towards each other. This week, dear God, as we go through this journey called life, give us eyes to look behind us and notice that goodness and mercy are following us, chasing us. Your goodness is running after us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Please join us in singing One Love.